हरिओं श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। शुक्लं वरदरं विष्णुं शशिवर्णं चतुर्भुजं प्रसन्नवदनं ध्यायेत् सर्वविघ्नोपशान्तये। टुडे इज द फिफ्थ सेशन ऑफ भगवद गीता वर्स बाय वर्स। अ वार्म वेलकम फ्रॉम द परम वेदांत टीम। अर्जुना वाज इमेंसली टैलेंटेड, नॉलेजेबल, बट स्पिरिचुअली ही रिप्रेजेंट्स मेनी ऑफ अस with doubts, fears, vulnerabilities, and insufficient clarity. Now, Arjuna had a very special quality, anusuyave. Asuya means fault-finding. Anusuyave is na vidyate asuya asya saha, the one who does not unreasonably raise complaints about things that are not important. Arjuna was non-critical and did not have intellectual arrogance. This was one of the reasons Krishna chose to give this sacred knowledge of self to Arjuna over the other brothers, even Yudhishthir. Shastras give many examples. These examples have their limitations. We must attempt to understand the intention of the example provided. As a non-fault finder, we will be able to see the magnanimity of things instead of the holes and drawbacks. Pray for the speakers and the listeners that we use this knowledge for spiritual growth and not just reduce it to academic egotism or academic pursuit. Today, our six speakers will be covering 10 verses from chapter 2. Dr. Ashwini will be chanting these verses for us. But first, let's listen to last week's recap by Dr. Sanjay Mehrotra. Over to you, Dr. Sanjay.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. All Shastras are teaching us that our real nature is Chaitanya Swarupam. Our physical personality, our emotional personality, and our intellectual personalities are all incidental in nature. The key points which need to be understood is that if you know the real self, you should play the game of life and do not grieve. The most important expression of Bhagavad Gita lies in the 11th verse of the second chapter, which says, Nanu Shochanti Pandita. Here lies the whole convey of the value of what this Shastra is teaching us, that we should not grieve. And this needs Atma Anatma Viveka, which means that one has to know what is Atma, Atma ka. The study of Vedanta would provide certain understanding about death and eternal nature of Atma in this perishable body. Next slide. Krishna is telling a spiritual seeker must know what is Atma. Atma is Avinashinam, Ajam, Nityam, and Avyayam. Why an ordinary individual does not know his dear nature, and the reasons are two, is ignorant. And Atma is so intimate to the body-mind complex and is covered, is avaranam, is hidden. Now, there are two points which are important for us to understand. One is we have to separate the Atma from the body. Next slide, please. And the second point is, who am I? I am not the body. Body is matter and continuously changing, childhood to old age. My I feeling is separate from the body and changeless. What about Atma? In the verse 22nd, Krishna tells what happens to Atma after death. Vasanshi jiranani yatha vihai navani grahati naroparani tatha sharirani vihaya jirana Nyanyani Sanyati Navani Dehi. Next slide, please. Now, verse 23 and 24 are similar in expression, and Krishna says, the Atma cannot be cut, not burned, cannot be wetted, and cannot be dried. This is eternal, all-pervading, changeless, immovable, and unborn. Nainam Chindanti Shastrani, Nainam Dahati Pavaka, Na Chainam Kledyantapo, Na Shoshayati Marutaha. Next slide, please. Now, Krishna is concluding in verse 25, the Atma Swarupam discussion. Atma is not available for perception by the senses and is free from shatvikara. It is avikaryam. Krishna tells Arjuna to all seekers that all of us have the same Atma, Krishna including. Therefore, sochitam na arhasi, you should not grieve. Avyaktam ayam achintam ayam avikaryam ayam uchyate. Tasmat evam viditva enam na anu shochitam arhasi. Next slide, please. In verse 26, Krishna says that however, if you can consider this Atma to be constantly born and constantly dying, even then you should not grieve like this, O Arjuna. The Shunyavadis and Charuvakas consider Atma or the body to be subject to birth and death. Atham chainam nityajatam nityam va manyate mratam tathapitvam mahabahu nainam shochitum arhasi. Next slide, please. Continuing in verse 27, he says, jatasthi dhruva mrityuhu dhruvam janma mratasyacha tasmat aparihare arthe natvam shochitum arhasi. What is born is subject to decay and death. What is dead is going to be born. This is the cycle of life. No one can escape the death, but death is not the end of the jiva. We don't have many choices as jiva because it is mortal. The body is mortal, and it is important for us to gracefully accept the choiceless, which is death. Krishna says, hey Arjuna, aparihare arthe na tvam shochitum na arhasi. Do not grieve. Next slide, please. Now, this is a beautiful verse, which is Avyaktadini Bhutani Vyaktam Madhyani Bharataha Avyakta Nidhanani Eva Tatraka Parivedana. The manifest universe originally came from nothingness and after destruction goes to nothingness. Science says the same and Krishna is saying the same. All living beings' manifestations is only in the middle. And before and after it is avyakta. Therefore, what is the need to worry about the material existence? Now, Krishna has talked about the Atmaswarupam, our real nature. Body-mind complex is anatma. But it's very difficult to understand this Atmaswarupam. And he says, Ashcharyavat paschit kaschit enam, Ashcharyavat vadati tatha evacha anyaha. Ashcharyavat cha enam anyashranoti shrutva api enam vedana cha eva kaschita. Atmasarup, nature of Atma, is not easy to understand. And one sees this Atma as a wonder, another speaks as a wonder, and another hears as a wonder, and yet another is not able to understand despite hearing. Next slide, please. So Krishna is summarizing what he has said so far. The mortal body is subject to old age, disease, and death, and we cannot conquer these things. One should prepare himself for death. This mental preparation is the first lesson. Behind the mortal body is the real I, and this is called as Dehi. Dehi Nityam Avadhya. This indestructible Atma is encased in all bodies. Dehi Nityam Avadhya Ayam Dehe Sarvasya Bharataha Tasmat Sarvani Bhutani Natvam Shochitum Arhasi. O Arjuna, this Atma present in everybody is ever indestructible. Therefore, you should not grieve for the sake of any being. These verses from the last class are the most important verses of Bhagavad Gita. And we are lucky to recap them as myself. My salutations to all of you and hope the coming verses will give you some insight about ourselves. Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay, for a wonderful summary of the last week's class. Sadashiva Samarambam Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Pariyantam Vande Guru Paramparam Om. As we continue our study of the next set of verses, today we will be looking at verses from 31 to 40. And I would like to focus your attention on what is that we really need to pick up as Krishna is instructing all of us. The instruction in this Gita is to Arjuna, and the context is the battlefield. We have to make those adjustments that Arjuna has to be replaced by ourselves, and Arjuna's sorrow. So Arjuna has been incapacitated by sorrow because of his attachment to his loved ones. Even the thought of losing his loved ones has made him, made such a great warrior, a person who's incapable of serving in the battlefield. Krishna has two objectives. One is, all his instructions are with a smile on his face, which means again and again in all these verses and in the previous class, you will say again, Krishna says, please do not be sorrowful. Please do not grieve. Krishna's one central message is, do not grieve. Because if you are grieving, you are not able to function in this world. From verses 12 to verse 25, he takes off by giving a spiritual approach. He gives the quintessence of all Vedanta and tells Arjuna very clearly, and through Arjuna to all of us, don't take your life very seriously. Play your role sincerely, because you are someone other than what you normally think of. Once you know who you are, then you will realize life is a game and you need to enjoy your game. But then Krishna soon realizes that it has not made a difference to Arjuna and probably not made a difference to all of us. So he's shifting gears. He's coming to this set of verses for today's class. It's absolutely practical, very meaningful, very worldly, very down to earth. For all of us, our suffering is real. And whenever those of us who are in a problem-solving role as doctors, or in any role as a parent, as a role when we have to deal with people suffering, the first thing we need to understand is whoever is coming to us with a unit of suffering, that person's suffering for him or for her is absolutely real. We need to take it as real, and therefore giving all these philosophical inputs is not going to make a difference to the sorrow. The person wants his problem to be solved, and therefore, whatever in our field of influence, let us see how we can mitigate the person's suffering by doing what we can. But once we know that there is nothing else that can be done, then we need to look at philosophical and practical approaches. When Gautama Buddha became enlightened and he made his first sermon, he said this is what he discovered, that this world is full of suffering. And he also was able to find that there is a cause for the suffering. The cause for our suffering is because of our attachment, very similar to what Vedanta says, and our inability to accept reality as it is. Once we are able to understand the cause of suffering, there will also be an end to suffering. And he gives us the Eightfold Path. Whenever we go through a unit of suffering, the person who's going through suffers not only the suffering, but a tremendous sense of a low self-esteem. The person who's supposed to fight a situation which is very real, now suddenly finds himself or herself on the back foot. And when there is a sense of low self-esteem, you are not able to help yourself. And those of us who are in problem-solving role, one of our important role is to help the person to regain self-esteem, that he or she is okay, and thereby empower a person in whatever way you can to be able to fight one's own battle, because all of us can be only supportive role. And that is what we have heard in the previous verses. And that's why we need to bank on all these verses like Matra Sparsha Sukaunteya. The good and the bad will come and go. And therefore, we need to be able to strengthen ourselves to be mentally strong. Now, the verses here will tell us very practical and down-to-earth approaches to the problem of suffering. What do we all want in life? We all want Sukha Prapti and Dukkha Nivritti. but what is the reality of the life? You will see when it comes to the 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna shows his glory in his Vibhuti. But when it comes to the 11th chapter, Krishna shows the world is full of good things, the world is full of terrible things. While there is Sukha, there is Dukkha also. And therefore, we need to be able to squarely face the good as well as the bad. There is a story some of you would know about a mother waking up her son because the son is refusing to get up. And the mother says, son, get up, it's time to go to school. And the son tells the mother, I don't want to go to school because the students don't like me and the teachers also don't like me. So the mother insists, but you have to go to school. You are 50 years old and you are the principal. Now, this is our situation. Even though things are unpleasant, although we want Sukha Prapti and Dukkha Nivritti, you will see in life, we need to be able to encounter our suffering. When we face our suffering, when we are able to meditatively experience and go through the suffering, you will see what happens. We begin to learn from our suffering. And this is what Krishna will say in these words. It is said that when you win, you win. When you lose, if you learn, Krishna is trying to say how you can learn and how you can grow from all the experiences of your life, especially the bad experiences, where you can convert an unpleasant incident, you can convert your scars into stars. In the first talk, which will be by Dr. Bhaskar, Krishna introduces the concept of Swadharma. Now, dharma is of two types. One is called Samanya Dharma, which is common to everybody. And this is part of Yama and Niyama, which you have in the five things to avoid, like avoid himsa, avoid lying, avoid stealing, avoid any inappropriate sexual behavior, and not to have over possession or not to be possessive. These are the five don'ts which apply to everybody. Why is dharma important? Because if you go against dharma, you will have to pay a price. There will be sorrow. Then there is the niyama, saucham, santosha, tapaha, swadhyaya, what we're doing right now, scriptural study, and ishvara pranidhana, being able to accept the will of God. This is samanya dharma. And then there is something called Swadharma or Vishesha Dharma, which will be explained in the first talk that we will go through, and that will be by Dr. Bhaskar. Over to you, Dr. Bhaskar.
Om Guru Bhyo Namaha. So, Bhagavan Sri Krishna is convincing Arjuna at three different levels of discussion to fight the Dharma Yuddha. First one is Adhyatmika Drishti, Dharmik Drishti, and Laukika Drishti. The Adhyatmika Drishti ends at 30th verse with some inputs. Sarvasya Dehe Vrataha Bharataha. Bhagavan says, body which is mortal, and having appreciated this fact, extend the same law with regard to Bhishma and Drona Shariram. Sarvani Bhutani Soshitam Na Arasi. You should never grieve over any living beings or death of any living beings. Accept it as a fact. Grief is never going to change a fact. O Partha, if you don't understand Atma, doesn't matter. From Swadharma point of view, you should not hesitate to fight. You should not think they are your gurus and swajanas, because Dharma is Shashvatam. So here, Bhagavan Sri Krishna is giving medicine to not only Arjuna's sorrow, but also to his delusion. At this point, if Arjuna understood Atma Jnana, he requires no other solutions. Unfortunately, even many people don't grasp the Adhyatmik Drishti, which requires some amount of maturity. Example, when a person goes on doing all akarma and tells, I am Atma, I am Akarta and Abhokta, just as Krishna is asking Arjuna to fight, anybody can kill another person and say, after all, body is perishable and I have not killed the real person because real person is eternal. Therefore, murderer can abuse Vedantic teaching. So if maturity is not there, Vedanta can be easily misinterpreted. Uniqueness of this scripture are seemingly contradictions because it addresses people of different level of spiritual evolution. That is adhikari bedaha at the same time. So Vedanta can really coexist only with Dharma. Arjuna fighting this war is proper as Drona and Bhishma are on adharmic side. So Bhagavan Krishna uses a technical term Swadharma to convince Arjuna in verse 2.31. Lord Krishna, he himself explains his own Swadharma in verse 3.24. Coming to the verse proper, Swadharmam api cha vekshaya na vikampitum harasi dharmyadi yuddha shreyonyat kshatriyasya na vidyate. Moreover, considering your own duty also, you should not waver, because for a warrior, nothing else is greater than the righteous war. So here, Dharma is again is divided into Samanya Dharma and Vishesha Dharma. Samanya Dharma is already been explained by Sir. So Vishesha Dharma varies from groups to group, whether he is a Brahmana, Kshatriya or Vaishya, whether he is a Brahmachari, Grihastha or a Sannyasi, whether male or female. Duty is an individual, a duty of an individual depends upon his designation in life. This Vishesha Dharma is Swadharma for Arjuna because he is a Kshatriya, so he should fight the Dharma Yuddha. Further, every Utsarga has an Apavad. This is in Sanskrit. Therefore, when Utsarga is general rule, Apavada is an exception. Therefore, when Sama, Dana, Veda, all non-violent method fails, killing is allowed for the sake of maintaining law and order. So, Imsa is the last resort in Dharmic Drishti. So, coming to verse 2.32, here, Bhagavan gives benefit of Dharma Yuddha. The verse goes like this. Edarchaya kopapannam swadargam swargadwaram aparvatam sukinaha kshatriyaha partha labhyante yuddham idrasam. O Partha, only fortunate kshatriya gets such a righteous war which has come to you by chance and which is an open gateway to heaven. According to Dharma Shastra, when a person sacrifices his life for Dharma, he attains Veera Swarga. So Kshatriya attains Veera Swarga not by rituals or other means, only by sacrificing their life for the sake of Dharma. So Dharma Yuddha is a gateway to heaven. And that too, what type of headway? Aparvatam Swargadwaram. It is an open door. Who will get such an opportunity? Sukinaha Kshatriyaha Hidrasam Yuddham Labante. Only fortunate blessed Kshatriya can get such an opportunity for the noble cause. So Arjuna, don't miss this opportunity. This verse also stands as a solution for the present dilemma of doctors or any professionals, because one should follow our Swadharma as a doctor or a social servant in this global crisis. Hari Om, sir.
Hari Om, Sri Gurubhyo Nama. So the Dharmika Drishti is continuing from verse number 31 up to verse number 33. Lord Krishna is trying to persuade Arjuna to fight the war in ethical angle. So the verse goes like this. Atha chetvamimam dharmyam sangramam na karishyasi tada swadharmam kirtimcha hitva papam avapsisi. Krishna said that you have to fight the war by which you will attain heaven. And if you do not fight the war, not only you will not get heaven, on the other hand, you are going to hell only. Because if a person renounces his duty, that omission of the duty is considered to be a papam, according to Shastra. According to Shastra, papam is divided into two types, in the form of doing what should not be done. That is called as nishiddha karanam, commission of duty. And second is, that is not doing what should be done, called as vihita karana, if Arjuna does not fight this war, it will comes under vihita karana, that is omission of duty, otherwise called as pratyavaya papa. Here Lord Krishna says, adha chet tvamimam dharmyam sangramam na karishyasi. Arjuna, if you do not fight this righteous war, that is dharmika yuddham, then adha swadharmam hitva, you will be omitting your duty, and for that you will incur papam. Papam avapsyasi. What is the consequence of papam? Suffering in this janma, if not in this janma, in the future janmas also. Therefore Arjuna, you may not be interested in swarga, but at least to avoid narakam, you have to fight this war. Not only you will get naraka, kirtim cha hitva, you will lose your name and fame also. With this sloka, dharmic drishti or ethical angle is over. And Krishna's argument is that this war is ethical and therefore you should fight. And next verse goes like this. Akirtim cha chapi bhudani kathayishyanti devayam sambhavidasya chakirtir maranadadirichyate. After having given the philosophical view and ethical view, now Lord Krishna is coming down to further to laukika drishti, that is empirical or worldly angle. So people may think that I do not believe in punyam and papam, that is the personal, that is the present society, because punyam and papam cannot be perceived by sense organs, that which cannot be experimentally demonstrated. It is not available for scientific establishment. It is only known through shastra pramana. Therefore a person may say that I do not believe in punyam or papam, I do not believe in swargam or narakam, so then can I run away from the war? If we ask to Lord Krishna, Krishna will say that still you have to fight the war. If you do not fight this war, your status in the society, respect that you enjoy in the society, will come down. You will lose your name and fame. And therefore Krishna argues Arjuna, you have got such a name and fame, you are considered the greatest warrior in the world, all glories you have. Now after seeing the opponents, you got scared. People will spread all kinds of rumors, and not only that, poems after poems will be written. And even after 20 centuries, people will talk about Arjuna who ran away in the battlefield. So Krishna says, bhudani kadaishyandi. All the people will talk insulting you, criticizing you, and they will spread rumors. Agirtim kadaishyandi. They will give you permanent apamanam or infamy, which is avyayam. Avyayam means it will be passed from generation to generation. Avyayam akirtim bhudani. Bhudani means human beings. They will spread rumor. Therefore he says, sambhavitasya, having enjoyed the fame as the greatest warrior, the most courageous person having enjoyed the fame, suddenly being dropped down, akirtim, ill fame is maranat adirichate, is worse than death. And therefore Arjuna, better die than live with ill fame. Thank you, sir.
Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. After Arjuna surrendered to Lord Krishna, Lord Krishna had twofold goals in front of him. One is to give across the jnanam, atma jnanam, for posterity through Arjuna. And his immediate goal was to make the best able warrior in the Pandava side get up and wage this war. So we have seen thus far that he accomplishes these two goals from three angles, the philosophical, worldly, and ethical angle. In the next slide, we shall see the arguments why Lord Krishna is putting forth the worldly angle. So the ethical angle depended on the acceptance of dharma, swarga, punyam, papam, all of which is not tangible. So for those who then argue that they would not believe in this because they are not tangible, Lord Krishna suggests, at least you would believe in your self-image, you would believe in name and fame. At least for this, can you wage this war? As we see in the next slide, he is covering the worldly angle at three levels. The previous speaker has spoken about what will people think, what will happen to your self-image in the eyes of common people. In the next two verses now, Lord Krishna is coming forth and telling what will great men think and what will your enemies think. भयाद्रणादुपरतं मांस्यन्ते त्वां महारथा एसां चत्वां बहुमतः भूत्वा यास्यसि लाघवम्। महारथः ग्रेट वॉरियर्स मांस्यन्ते विल कंसिडर त्वां भयाद्रणादुपरतं आउट ऑफ फियर यू रैन अवे फ्रॉम द बैटलफील्ड एसां चत्वां बहुमतः भूत्वा among whom you have been honorable for your great skills, yasyasi laghavam, you shall gain insignificance, you shall fall to disgrace. Arjuna, it is said, even waged war with Lord Shiva and equaled him, and he got from him the Pashupashastra Astram. For a person with such a reputation, Lord Krishna is working on his reputation and telling that you will fall in the eyes of these great warriors. The point in this verse is what Arjuna believed the cause for withdrawal from this war as compassion, that if he doesn't do so, the family, the society will collapse, is an intention which is there in the mind, which is not evident outside. So Lord Krishna is telling, nobody will believe that you are doing this out of compassion. Rather, everybody will believe that you ran away because you are afraid of fighting this battle. In the next slide, we shall see Lord Krishna telling Arjuna, what will the enemies think? Ava chavadams cha bahun vadishyanti tavahitaha nindantastava samarthyam tato dukkatarum nukim. Tavahitaha, your enemies, vadishyanti, they will utter bahun avachya vadams, many unmentionable words. Tava samarthyam nindantaha, they will ridicule your great abilities. Tata dukkatarum nukim, what can be more painful than this? A kshatriya warrior is supposed to have a big ego. Here, Lord Krishna is working on Arjuna's ego and trying to push him to get up and wage this war. As we shall see in the next slide, which happens to be the conclusion slide for the entire ethical and the worldly angle, represented by the word tasmad. We also see in the verse 230, the word tasmad, where it referred to the conclusion of the philosophical angle. Ato va prapsyase swargham jitva va bhokshase mahim tasmad uttista kaunteya yuddhaya krita nischayah hatova prapsyasi swargam. This goes back to the ethical angle where Lord Krishna said a kshatriya warrior, for him a dharma yuddham is a gateway to heaven. So if you are killed, you shall gain swargam. Jitva va bhokshase mahim is a reference to the worldly angle. If you win, you will have your self-image preserved. You will enjoy great name and fame. Therefore, combining all the arguments what he has set forth till now, he is asking, Uttishta Kaunteya, first may you get up out of your dejection, and Yuddhaya Krita Nischayaha, take to this war with full conviction. Thank you, sir.
Hari Om, Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. We come to verse 38. Sukha dukkhe same kritva labha labho jaya jayau tato yuddhaya yujyasva naivam papam avapsyasi. Having made pleasure and pain, gain and loss, victory and defeat the same, you engage in battle for the sake of battle. Thus you shall win and not incur sin, says Krishna to Arjuna. This shloka is a transition shloka where Krishna's teaching in this chapter shifts from Jnana or Sankhya Yoga with a slight hint upon the technique of Karma Yoga before dealing in depth with Karma Yoga. Next slide, sir. After placing before Arjuna the arguments from various angles, as we have just heard from Dr. Sundar, the Adhyatmika angle, that is the philosophical angle, the dharmika, the ethical or the moral angle, where he appeals to his sense of duty, and then the laukika angle,
the social angle, which points out sensibility to shame. Like he said, you may lose your name and fame. He says, fight, Arjuna. And how? With perfect detachment. Now, every challenge that appears before us must be evaluated from the spiritual standpoint, emotional level of ethics and morality, and of course, the physical level of social speculation and the customs. Now, if all these things are not contradictory and all of them point to one single truth, then that is the path we must take. As we have seen, Arjuna's delusion overpowered his mind, and therefore he surrendered to Krishna, who served as the discriminative intellect. He was the true charioteer, that is, of the Upanishads. The next slide, sir. So if we want to go swimming in the sea, we must know how to swim. We must know how to ride the waves if we should avoid being washed away or drowned. Life is full of waves, like the dvandas or pairs of opposites, which are mentioned in this shloka at the three levels of existence. Sukha, dukkha, any favorable or unfavorable experience which causes pleasure and pain at the intellectual level. Labha, labha, that is the gains and the losses which are associated with the joys and the sorrows at the mental level. And the jaya, jaya, victory and defeat, personal winning and losing at the physical level. Next slide, sir. Our folly is that we expect life to be without waves. Swami Chinmayananda says, we have to learn to stand astride like a lighthouse on the bedrock of the sea. So Krishna's advice to Arjuna in this shloka is, meet the challenge with detachment. Let go of all the anxieties that come with the identification of oneself with the anatma. And the message to all of us in this shloka is, we have to do our duty with an attitude of samatva, that is the key word here, or equanimity, even in the face of challenges, like as medical practitioners in this pandemic or the soldiers in a war zone. With sama, mind control, managing the mind, mano nigraha, comes discrimination. With vishama, the disturbed mind loses control and the discriminatory power. One other important thing, with this equanimity of mind, we are in a position to exhaust the vasanas which are already there within us and thus achieve mental purification. And if we work with this attitude, we will never have a spiritual downfall, says Krishna. Naivam papam avapsyasi. Hari Om, thank you.
Hari Om. एषा ते अभिता सांख्ये बुद्धिर्योगे त्वमां शृणु बुद्ध्या युक्तो यया पार्थ कर्मबन्धं प्रहास्यसि. दिस नॉलेज इम्पार्टेड टू यू टिल नाउ डील्स विथ आत्मा. नाउ यू लिसन टू द फॉलोइंग टीचिंग विच डील्स विथ कर्मयोग. Endowed with this knowledge, you will give up all the bondage of karma, O Arjuna. So this shloka is a transit verse. Krishna is moving from one topic to another, from jnana yoga to karma yoga. Esha buddhi abhita te sankhe partha. Next slide. O Arjuna, this knowledge imparted to you till now dealt with atma. Here, sankhya means atma and buddhi means knowledge, not intellect. Yoge tvimam shruno. Now listen, I'm going to give you the following teaching which deals with yoga. Krishna means karma yoga here when he says yoge. Note, throughout the Gita, the word yoga has very different meanings in different contexts. Therefore, in every context, we have to ask the question, what is the meaning? So here Shankaracharya says, yoga is equal to karma yoga. In the second line, Krishna glorifies karma yoga, yukta yaya buddhya, endowed with this knowledge. Which knowledge? This knowledge of karma yoga. Karma bandham prahasyasi. You will destroy all the shackles born out of karma. You will attain liberation. Now, a word of caution. Krishna earlier has clearly said that Jnana Yoga alone can free a person from sorrow and delusion. There are not several paths to moksha. It's not like since Jnana Yoga is tough, we can try Karma Yoga for moksha. But then why does Krishna say in this verse, Karma Yoga will break all the shackles of bondage? Adi Shankaracharya explains, Krishna is glorifying Karma Yoga just like we would glorify a primary school without which we cannot be prepared for the higher grades. Karma Yoga only indirectly liberates by taking you to Jnanam, self-inquiry. It prepares us by giving us Chitta Shuddhi, Guru Prapti, and Jnana Yogata. One cannot enter Jnana Yoga without the initial preparation. To understand our true nature is very difficult. Karma Yoga helps to prepare the mind. The mind has to be disciplined, controlled, redirected inwards. Karma Yoga helps in purification of the mind and a change of attitude. It is a stepping stone. The mind has to be prepared gradually, steadily. It has to be made subtler. Karma Yoga helps with developing the fourfold qualifications, the sadhana chatushtaya sampatti. Swami Paramatmananda ji says, Jnana Yoga is impossible without Karma Yoga, and Karma Yoga is incomplete without Jnana Yoga. Just like you cannot come to the 10th grade without going through the lower classes, and just going through the lower classes of study is not good enough. Also, a few words about liberation. By liberation, do not think it involves going to the forest, leaving your family, or having some mystical powers or experiences. Nor is it some kind of posthumous business that will take us to some higher loka after death. Liberation means freedom from all kinds of emotional problems. Anxiety, fear, depression, worry, all these are called samsara. It is a freedom from the chattering of thoughts. Liberation means enjoying a personal, a wonderful mind, a mind which has the ability to handle these emotions without them becoming a burden, being at peace, whatever the situation. All this happens when we recognize our true nature. Here afterwards, Krishna will give us an elaborate introduction to Karma Yoga, which we will listen. Hari Om.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. After talking about the Jnana Yoga, from verse number 11 to 25, now Lord Krishna wants to concentrate on Karma Yoga. And before starting the topic of Karma Yoga, Sri Krishna wants to make certain general observations regarding Karma Yoga and Karma Yogis. What exactly is Karma Yoga? This we'll be seeing later. But to put it in a nutshell, Karma Yoga is that way of life in which we grow internally and we give importance to inner growth more than external accomplishment. It's like shifting gears, as we see here, delinking whatever we do from the material outcomes and linking it, measuring it only in terms of lessons learned and the inner growth. Because the basic philosophy in Gita is this: the peace of mind does not depend upon what you have. On the other hand, peace of mind depends upon what you are. So Karma Yoga is a lifestyle in which we focus more on inner growth, and comparatively the outer external accomplishments are subservient to the inner growth. Not that we ignore external possessions. We respect money, we respect possessions, we respect status. All of them are respected. But when there is a comparison between inner growth and external accomplishment, a Karma Yogi focuses more on inner growth. And if he is asked to choose one of these two, Karma Yogi will choose inner growth more. And such a lifestyle is called Karma Yoga. The details we'll be seeing later, but here we are going to see its glorification. Next slide, sir. So verse 40, Neha Bikrama Nashosti Pratyavayo Na Vidyate Swalpamapyasya Dharmasya Trayate Mahato Bhayat. In this field of Karma Yoga, there is no failure, there is no adverse result. Even a little bit of this discipline protects one from the great fear of samsara. Krishna says, Neha Bikramam Nashosti. Here it means karma yoga. There's no such thing called failure. Karma yogi never feels that he has failed in life, because even though he might be a failure from the worldly angle, because he failed in business or lost money or something, the world may say he's a failure. But karma yogi, he is going to look at it from the standpoint of the lessons learned, valid lessons which he has learned from such experiences. And since he feels lessons are very valid and important, while the world says he's a failure, he says, I have got a lot of inner growth, that which I consider as success. And therefore, a karma yogi does not know failure. Abhikramanasha means failure. Classical example given by Adi Shankaracharya is krishi, agriculture. In agriculture, you have to sow seeds, put water, pesticide, manure, and then wait for rain to come well in time, and only then there will be a harvest. Like syntax in computer coding. If there's a slight mistake in syntax, a small error, there will be zero output. However, unlike in these cases, in karma yoga, there is no failure due to small errors. Whatever may be the material outcome, a karma yogi will gain internally. He'll grow spiritually by learning the lessons, and he considers that lessons as success. Similarly, pratyavayo na vidyate. Pratyavaya here means adverse result. From a material angle, any action can have positive result or adverse result. When I do business, if I get profit, it's positive. If I lose money, then it's adverse result. If I get some disease and if I take some medicine, some medicines will have adverse reactions. Like I take a tablet for headache, it may cause gastritis. That adverse reaction is pratyavaha. From material angle, actions will have positive and negative result. But for a spiritual person, action will have only positive result, because from any experience, a karma yogi learns. So in the path of karma yoga, there's no failure and no adverse result. And not only that, svalpamapyasya dharmasya. Even if he practices to a limited extent, to that extent, he will get proportional result. Whereas in case of material result, an action can produce a result only when it's completed. A karma will produce result only when it's completed. But in the case of karma yoga, whether the action is completed or not, inner growth will take place. Whether an action is done in half, whether it is done in 3/4, in 1/4, the karma yogi will get the proportionate benefit. Suppose you are chanting for purification of mind, nishkama, and in such case, even if you are chanting wrongly a bit, the benefit, Swamiji says, is supposed to accrue. Thus, what Krishna wants to say here is, sakama karma will have to be completed to produce the result, whereas nishkama karma, or karma for inner growth, will give result anyway. Svalpamapyasya dharmasya, even a little bit of karma yoga, trayate mahato bhayat, from samsara, the great fear called samsara, the karma yoga will protect a person. And therefore, so he says, Arjuna, be a karma yogi. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Komal, for giving us a nice introduction of the key topic of the Bhagavad Gita on karma yoga. Thanks to all the previous speakers who have done an excellent explanation of the verses allotted to them. The theme on this set of verses, where we were not dealing with self-knowledge, but we were dealing with a lot of worldly approaches to the twin problems of human suffering. All of us go through suffering. But are you going to feel sad? Are you going to grieve? If you're going to grieve, you're not going to be functional. You will not be able to do your swadharma. And Krishna has this twin approach. Do not grieve and do not allow your emotions to affect your work. Our classes from now on will be twice a week. So we need to work on the Gita classes twice now. The second chapter is one of the most beautiful chapters of the entire Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna summarizes the entire Gita message. After having a nice Upanishadic summary in the initial part of the second chapter, our next set of verses now will introduce the key topic of Karma Yoga, how you can transform our everyday activity. Normally we do karma, but Krishna wants to transform how our karma can become a yoga. In the nice slide that Dr. Komal showed us, normally whenever I do any karma, I will be incurring either a punya or a papa. But if you're able to do karma as a yoga, you will do your duty, but then you are not going to incur further punya or papa. These set of verses from 41 to 47, please read and come prepared, and especially the 47th and the very popular verse, which is Karmanyeva Adhikarasya, which is everyone is familiar with. We will now listen to the chanting of these 9-10 verses that we studied today by Dr. Ashwini Divakar. Over to you, Dr. Ashwini.
Thank you, sir. Hari Om. Swadharmamapi chaveksya navikampitumarhasi dharmyadhi yuddhachreyonyat kshatriyasya navidyate yadrichaya chopapannam swargadwaramapavratam sukhinah kshatriyah partha लभन्ते युद्धमीदृशम् अथ चेत्त्वमिमं धर्म्यं संग्रामं न करिष्यसि ततः स्वधर्मं कीर्तिं च हित्वा पापमवाप्स्यसि अकीर्तिं चापि भूतानि कथयिष्यन्ति ते व्ययाम् संभावितस्य चाकीर्तिः मरणादतिरिच्यते अवाच्यवादांश्च बहून् वदिष्यन्ति तवाहिताः निन्दन्तस्तव सामर्थ्यं ततो दुःखतरं नु किम् हतो वा प्राप्स्यसि स्वर्गं जित्वा वा भोक्ष्यसे मही तस्मात् उत्तिष्ठ कौन्तेय युद्धाय कृतनिश्चयः सुखदुःखे समे कृत्वा लाभालाभौ जयाजयौ ततो युद्धाय युज्यस्व नैवं पापमवाप्स्यसि एषा ते विहिता सांख्ये बुद्धिर्योगे त्विमां शृणु बुद्ध्या युक्तो यया पार्थ कर्मबन्धं प्रहास्यसि नेहाभिक् क्रमनाशोस्ति प्रत्यवायो न विद्यते स्वल्पमप्यस्य धर्मस्य त्रायते महतो भयात् हरिः ओम् श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम् थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू टू ऑल द स्पीकर्स एंड अ ग्रेटिट्यूड टू सर Thank you to Dr. Ashwini for lending your sweet voice to the verses. He heard, life is a university. Every experience, especially adverse situations, teach us a lesson. Let us learn from them and not grieve over them. Let us also ponder over some key words that were used today, swadharma, sambhav. On a coming Monday, 24th May, we will have our next session of Bhagavad Gita verse by verse. Please log in at 6:45 p.m. Indian Standard Time. Also note, from now on, we will be having 2 classes per week on Bhagavad Gita, every Mondays and Fridays, same time. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om